Welcome to the With Chinese Characteristics podcast. I'm Natalie.
I'm Cherry.
And together we talk about topics with Chinese characteristics, whatever those might be. So Cherry, what's our topic for today?
Our topic today is boycott with Chinese characteristics.
Okay.
Or, I haven't decided. Maybe we'll call it, what's up with all these Chinese boycotts? There's too many of them.
That's why don't you...
It's hard to catch, you know, it's that, difficult to catch up.
Is that from your comedy routine?
Yes.
You might need to work on that one a little bit more. Polish it.
In my alternative universe, I'm a stand-up comedian. So, in March 2021...
Oh, we're going right to it. Well, I was going to ask what brought on this topic, or are you about to talk about what brought it on?
I'm about to talk about what brought it on.
Excuse me then, okay.
In March 2021... Calls for boycotting and cancellation of H&M and many other international fashion brands went viral on Chinese social media.
Mm.
The hashtag #ISupportXinjiangCotton was posted millions of times online. H&M was the sacrificial lamb of the group, but as many as 200 brands or so were involved. Some big names you might have heard of, Nike, Adidas, Calvin Klein, Zara, Gap, you name it. These fashion companies stated that they do not use cotton products sourced from Xinjiang area of China in their supply chain due to concerns over alleged forced labor involved in the farming process of that cotton.
Quote unquote alleged.
Quote unquote alleged. That's what they said. We'll get into the details later.
Well, if they didn't say alleged, they would probably just get banned from China.
Probably.
So they're skating it.
Yeah. So, we'll get into details about this most recent high-profile boycott later. However, is this new? It's not. I'm answering my own question. If you think cancel culture is a problem in America, you just wait for this episode, I guess. I don't know what you're waiting for the rest of the episode.
Yeah.
Now we're going to take a time travel train.
Okay.
And go back to 1905.
Okay.
The first large-scale boycott of foreign commercial goods under the cause of nationalism China.
So this is where they started. This is where they draw their lineage from.
I don't know if they go, 100 years ago, we started the tradition of boycotting things.
Well, I guess I would say prior 150 years, you know, in the 1850, there just wasn't enough foreign stuff to boycott.
There wasn't enough nationalism to go around.
The famous trade policy of the Qing Empire, the Chinese Empire,
yeah,
was that they sold stuff, but you could only buy it in silver.
Yeah.
They would not buy any foreign goods.
That was famously the problem.
Yes. So there was nothing to boycott because you couldn't sell anything to China.
All the Western countries go, it's just a country with outdated military forces and all of our silver sitting there.
Yeah, we already deposited all the silver there. Maybe we should try and get it back.
Yeah.
But at this point, there's enough foreign trade that there's something to boycott.
There's some.
Yeah.
The first one, was the Chinese boycott of American goods of 1905.
What did we do to China?
Oh. The beautiful country. What could you have done to China?
So Megoran.
Yes, a beautiful country, you know, Chinese for America. Mm. In 1894, China signed a treaty with America called the Sino-American Treaty. It's also called Gracham-Yang Treaty.
Okay.
The two countries' government agreed to suspend immigration of Chinese laborers to the United States for 10 years, but allowed conditional readmission of immigrants who were visiting China.
Okay.
This happens after a long stream of Chinese exclusion acts.
Yeah, yeah. I guess listen to the pigtail ordinance if you want to hear about some of them. Our first episode.
Yes. But while researching this, I was thinking, because, you know, if you have a treaty to ban immigration, you must have had an immigration treaty that started the immigration.
Mm.
Maybe. And apparently in 1868, there was a treaty negotiated between China and America to allow unlimited freedom of Chinese, any Chinese, to immigrate to United States. The treaty also prohibited the U.S. from meddling into China's internal affairs. Sounds like a treaty that we will sign today. As well as granted American citizens privilege in China. That's when America was, it was playing nice. It needed miners.
And people to build the railroad.
Yes. And then in 1882, Chinese Exclusion Act happened. It would be in effect for 10 years. And it had banned skilled and unskilled laborers and Chinese employed in mining.
Okay.
Which, in effect, basically bans everyone. Because mm-hmm. it's very hard to prove you do not belong to this very broad definition of skilled and unskilled labor.
Mm.
Everyone is a skilled or unskilled laborer. On paper, they go, merchants are okay, scholars are okay.
But very few people.
Very few people can legally immigrate yeah. to the U.S. As one of these treaties, in 1894, China signed an official one with America in agreement to ban immigration. And 10 years later, times comes to the renewal.
Mm-hmm.
China this time refused to renew it. They wanted to renegotiate for a less strict and less harsh immigration treaty instead.
Okay.
Over the refusal of America, because only 2 years prior to this, Chinese Exclusion Act was renewed indefinitely in America. So they were closing the door indefinitely. So why would they change their mind 2 years later? Over the refusal of America, as well as the mistreatment of Chinese immigrants in America, a boycott of American goods were called upon. China denounced the treaty in 1904. The U.S. didn't care. So the boycott started. And it first started when the Chinese Consolidated Benevolent Association of San Francisco called upon the people of China to pressure the United States into treating the Chinese immigrants in America better. And back in China on the ground, the Shanghai Chamber of Commerce mobilized and started organizing in China to boycott American goods. It spread through major cities in China. Merchants, as the leading group of the boycott, stopped ordering and selling American goods. And at this time, mostly we're talking about consumer goods, such as cotton textiles, matches, cigarettes, flour, soap, candles, you know, hardware, stationery. The boycott extended to the Chinese diaspora in the Philippines, Singapore, Malaysia, and more.
Oh, wow.
It lasted about a year, and it gradually lost its momentum. Merchants started withdrawing, especially the ones that deal American goods. You know, gotta eat.
Yeah.
The Chinese government stopped supporting the movement officially, partially worried that it might turn into an anti-government movement instead. When emotions run high.
Yeah. And it ended with... Did it succeed?
Well, it just died.
Okay.
It did not change Chinese-American relations. If anything, it has strengthened, which is a good thing, it has strengthened the Chinese diaspora's connections with one another.
Mm.
Yeah. Then, only 3 years later, there was another incident.
What did America do this time?
No, no, no.
Oh, okay.
It's our other favorite country, Japan,
oh, okay.
this time. It was 1908.
When in this era of Chinese history, when is Japan not doing something that it needs to be boycotted for?
Exactly.
When is Japan not up to some shenanigans between, you know, 1880 and 1950?
I know, but this one's especially humiliating, apparently. All we talk about on this podcast is about the national shame of China. So many forms of it, so many incidents.
Century of
so it. Many times the knees bent. It is called the 1908 Tatsumaru Incident. And I might be butchering the Japanese here, so you know, bear with me. What happened was that in 1908, a Japanese ship called Dani Tatsumari carried large amounts of firearms, ammunition, and coal traveled from Japan to China. Or should I say Macau, because Macau wasn't part of China back then. It was a Portuguese
concession.
The actual number of firearms and ammunition on the ship seems debatable. Different sources name different numbers. However, they all agree it is a significant sum. Officially, it was ordered by a Portuguese weapons merchant in Macau.
Okay.
The ship was captured by Qing Emperor patrol boats. Allegedly, the firearms were actually ordered for the Chinese Revolutionary Alliance. Tongmenghui, Sun Yat-sen's little revolutionary party.
Oh, Sun Yat-sen, up to trouble again.
So the Qing government saw this as an illegal smuggling of arms. The officers from the patrol ship took the Japanese flag down and seized the ship. The Japanese government was not happy, particularly due to the symbolism of the Japanese flag being taken down publicly. And Portugal was on Japan's side. They were like, no, no, it's okay. It's our territorial sea. It's totally legal. You have no jurisdiction here. So this became an international diplomatic incident. And Japan demanded an apology and large sums of compensation. The Qing government refused. Japan pressed on. Eventually, the Qing government agreed to five demands. One, release of Tatsumaru, the ship. Two, compensation for damage. Three, purchase of arms. They got to buy the arms now. Because since no one else is going to buy them, I guess. 4, punishment of officials involved. 5, perhaps the most humiliating one, ceremonial fire of bombshells at the time of the ship return to show their sincere apologies.
You know, that's really the thing that's it's kind of sad. I mean, there's lots of sad things, but during this period, is the Chinese government will tell people like, oh, you know, we got to be harsh. We got to crack down on opium or foreigners or whatever. And then people will do it. And then the government will not have their backs. The famous guy, I'm sure you know his name, who burned all the opium.
Yeah.
And then the government, and then they complained like, well, who's going to pay for all this opium? And then China had to pay for the opium.
Exactly.
Yeah.
100 years of shame. Mm-hmm. Did I tell you about it? As a result. So these are humiliating terms. Although if you're the Qing government, you don't want arms to get to the hands of the little revolutionaries waiting in Macau.
It's easier fire off some salutes to Japan than it is to have a bunch of little Sun Yat-sens running around with guns. Yes,
it's called enemies within and enemies abroad. I guess they decided to deal with one before the other. So as a result, on March 19th, 1908, which was the release date of the boat, a public gathering was held in Guangzhou for commemorating the national shame. After these two incidents that kicked off our history of boycotting commercial goods for nationalism.
So they boycotted Japanese goods.
Okay.
But it presumably didn't change anything either.
Japan still invaded China. Mm-hmm. After these two incidents that kicked off our history of boycotting commercial goods for nationalism, namely, the next big one was the 21 demands of 1915. Japan again this time. Yuan Shikai, if you listen to our last episode, had signed this humiliating one-sided 21 demands from Japan. And the country wasn't happy. And then there was the May 4th movement of 1919, which was a Chinese anti-imperialist cultural and political movement that grew out of student protesting in Beijing on May 4th, 1919. Local commerce associations decided to cut commercial ties with Japanese companies. Times has changed. 1919, China was trading more with Japan. Japan was in Manchuria.
Building mines and factories and railroads and stuff.
Yeah, exploiting local resources, may I add. The economy is kind of more ingrained, and when that happens, the boycotting is a bit more damaging and more involved. So people refused to purchase Japanese goods. Workers who worked in Japanese factories in China went on strike. Students would even go out on the street and inspected shops to make sure that no one is secretly dealing Japanese goods. And the national government at the time also stood behind it and encouraged people to continue and keep up the boycott.
The interesting thing was there was a line from the biography of Reverend Chikai, or maybe both of them, that a lot of people wanted to boycott Japanese goods in 1915, but Ren Shikai was kind of afraid to because he thought, well, they might just invade us if we do a boycott, right?
They're going to invade you either way.
Yeah.
That's my guess. So.
Well, that's what happened.
So boycotting is not new. It's also not unique to China.
Yeah.
Every country at one point have boycotted some commercial goods, some other country or an industry or so on.
But China in this period has a lot of real grievances and the government is not able to address them or protect them. Yes. So I get why people just feel like, well, we got to just do this ourselves, right? We got to strike a blow.
Self-organized. Then we have World War II happened, Chinese Civil War happened, first 30, 40 years of the People's Republic of China happened.
Not a lot of foreign goods to boycott in 1960.
We were busy with other things, you know, not a lot of extra energy.
It was a utopia, Cherry. They didn't need any foreign goods.
Then, famously, China has opened up. We now have socialism with Chinese characteristics, which means we have a market economy. And people have some freedom. Apparently, as early as 1985, there was a boycott over Japanese commercial goods.
Well, there was a period, and correct me if I'm wrong, of like, especially like 1980 to like
early 2000s,
where really China had a stated foreign policy of like, we're not going to cause trouble, essentially, right?
We're going to keep our head down.
We're going to keep our head down.
Work on the economy.
We're going to be like the little orphan child of, can I have a, preferential trading status? Mm-hmm. You know, can we have this? You know,
we'll play by the rules
now. Yeah, we're cool now, right? We get developing nation status. Let's not rock the boat. Let's be nice.
Yeah.
And, but I think, eventually though, Chinese economy is large enough that now you can kind of throw some weight around.
Now we get to be the bully. Fast forward to 2005, another boycott over Japanese goods broke out. and what had triggered it this time. The first, which is no surprise, Japan is changing textbooks again. This is a thing that constantly happens. Every couple of years, you see on the news that Japan, somewhere in Japan, some province in Japan, some cities in Japan, are changing their textbooks.
Yeah.
To you know, downplay. Either downplay, deny the war crime.
Or even like the rationale behind the war.
Yeah.
Of like, oh, we were just trying to help our fellow Chinese people against colonialism.
Yes. And, you know, there's a lot of details. Like, at one point, they denied the existence of Korean...
comfort women.
Yes. But they do this very often. And also, I'm not, you know, playing devil's advocate, but it's rarely a national thing.
Yeah.
Sometimes these textbooks are used by as few as like 0.01% of students.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting, and this could be a whole separate episode, but in Japan, like it's not illegal in the same way it is in Germany to deny war crimes. You know what I mean? To be like essentially like a fascist.
Yeah.
Right.
No, there are political forces.
Yeah.
Small, however, they do exist, constantly work on
changing the narrative
of World War II.
Yeah.
And it is, I don't think it is the mainstream opinion of Japan. I don't live in Japan.
But you don't get like quote unquote canceled in Japan for saying that.
No.
They kind of can keep on saying it.
Not the same way in Germany. Yeah. So that wasn't good.
Yeah.
And then the bigger thing, however, was that at this time in 2005, there was a lot of effort that had happened to have Japan join the UN Security Council as a permanent member.
Oh.
So as a Chinese person, you know, my hair's gonna stand up like on the backs of my arm.
They're doing it again, Sherry.
Exactly. China as a country, and even sometimes Korea as a country, would feel kind of uneasy about that. And obviously we're not saying it's all innocent. It's, you know, it's a Game of Thrones.
Germany doesn't get to be on the Security Council.
Well, America backed Japan instead of Germany at that time. Germany was a contender. So I would feel also uneasy about Germany as well, considering two world wars. but you know, so there was a real effort and steps taken in making this happen.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, it hasn't happened. But it looked like it was a possibility in 2005. And large demonstrations in major Chinese cities broke out. Signatures were collected for pledges against Japan joining the UN Security Council as a permanent member. And by the way, Japan has been on the council, right? Like,
yeah,
there's
a
rotating, rotating members. But only five countries are sitting on the council as permanent members, China being one of them.
It's U.S., France, U.K., Russia, and China.
They do wield more power.
Because they can veto any measure.
They can veto anything. And it's a one-vote veto system, I believe. Mm-hmm. So some protesters threw rocks at Japanese stores, at Japanese cars. Police were dispatched all over China to maintain the order. However, the opposition...
And when you say Japanese cars, you don't mean cars owned by Japanese people.
No, I mean Hondas and Toyotas.
You mean that Chinese people own.
Yes. However, the opposition was pretty strong at the time in Chinese society. The mainstream media, which, let's say state medias, right, didn't report the large-scale protests. Rather, they mainly argued that China had opened up and its economy was integrated, and Japan is one of China's biggest trading partners, so, you know, let's chill here.
Mm-hmm.
So they were downplaying it and try to calm the people down. And the official attitude of the Chinese government was also a lot less wolf warrior-like back in 2005 compared to what we've seen in more recent years.
Yeah.
Answering questions by reporters on these protests and incidents, the Chinese Ministry of Foreign Relations, basically the Chinese State Department, stated that the protests broke out because the people of China are unhappy about Japan's attitude and reflections of its history of invasions of China, which is true.
Mm-hmm.
There's some truth to it. The Chinese government urges our people to remain calm and express our views orderly and within the frames of the law. We do not support radical violent actions. China had dispatched police force and security support for Japanese embassies in China, and so on. The Chinese-Japanese economic cooperation developed significantly over the past decade, yada yada, all the party lines. We do not wish for economic issues to be politicized. Both countries must work hard to maintain and improve the relationship.
Oh, where'd that China go?
So in no way they're saying, oh, this is absolutely wrong, right?
Yeah.
In no way they're saying that. Of course, there's some dog whistles in there.
Yeah.
However, they largely still maintained a very calm presence.
Yes.
And did not call or rile people up furthermore.
Mm-hmm.
Where did that China go? And then we fast forward to 2012. And obviously, these are not the only boycotts.
Yeah, these are the high water ones.
Yes, yeah, so we can sit here all day if we name all the ones against foreign business and the powers. But in 2012, there was another anti-Japanese boycott, and this was a big one.
I remember this one.
What had triggered it this time was because it was over the issue of Senkaku Islands. In Chinese, we call it 钓鱼岛.
I feel like somebody's going to get angry because you said the Japanese name first.
In no particular order of names. In Japanese and English, it's called Senkaku Islands. Hmm. In Chinese, it's called 钓鱼岛. It's a group of uninhabited islands in the East China Sea. These islands are a focus point of territorial dispute between China and Japan. And might I add, both Chinas are involved. There's only one China. That's the party line. But, you know, we're all involved.
So Taiwan's involved.
Too. Taiwan's involved, yeah. Because we claim that the discovery and ownership of the island from the 14th century by the Chinese people makes it ours.
Okay.
Japan has more of the actual control of the islands. But they're not developing it. They're just, you know, they're uninhabited. It's just sitting there.
Possession is 9/10 of the law.
And, you know, recent years, they discovered more undersea oil reserve and all that. It's a rock.
Or a couple of rocks.
With some possible potentials of resources.
Okay, around it.
But I would argue the bigger value of it is the face value.
Okay.
That's what I think. No one pays me to, you know, but Japanese coast guards and Chinese ships often play a game of cat and mouse. Around these sea areas.
Spray each other with hoses and stuff.
Fishing and civilian boats are prevented from getting too close. In 2012, there were some steps taken by the Japanese government to formalize and legalize its territorial claim over these islands. And some Chinese activists, nationalists, decided to travel and land on these islands. They were captured, arrested by Japanese law enforcement, released a few days later. This had triggered a wave of protests and demonstrations in China, because that's like, to them, it's like Chinese people getting arrested on Chinese land by the Japanese law enforcement.
Century of shame is back, Cherry.
Exactly. We're all reminded of the shame. The protests and demonstrations had quickly evolved into a boycott of all Japanese goods in China. And it got out of control pretty quickly. Protests were smashing Japanese cars on the streets, which there were a lot of Japanese cars in China at the time.
Probably most cars were Japanese cars.
Exactly. And there was even a police car in Shenzhen that was a Japanese car, and it was attacked as well. Japanese restaurants were attacked. Tech malls, you know, which are malls that sell tech products such as cameras and computers, which would be full of Japanese goods at this time, well, and now, you know, anywhere else in the world too, I believe, were attacked and looted. In addition, this was in fall, so September 18th was approaching. And that date holds a significance to China, because in 1931, it was called the Mukden Incident in English. There was a false flag event that was staged by Japanese military personnel as a pretext for the 1931 Japanese invasion of Manchuria.
And this isn't like a conspiracy theory. This was clearly, it was a false flag. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Japanese blew up their own railroad and they blamed it on China.
They said it was China. China did it, right? And they used it as an excuse for any other further military actions.
Yeah. And they did a couple of those false flags.
So actually this day, which September 18th, was listed as the official National Shame Day by the then government of the Republic of China.
Here's the thing, right?
Yeah.
Obviously, a lot of terrible, horrible things happened to China and Chinese people during those years.
Yes.
But in some ways, modern Chinese government's response to that trauma is...
It's asset. You got to utilize it.
Yeah.
To your own advantage.
I guess. National
I'm
Shame
not here
Day.
To criticize the National Shame Day, but I'm just saying
Wait,
it's
is
a
it
thing.
Again? What day
September
is
18th. 九一八.
Are we going to celebrate National Shame Day?
No, we're not. No, it's not a day to celebrate.
Okay, can we...
It's a day to commemorate national shame.
Okay.
So I didn't know that it was listed by the Republic of China. In recent years, Taiwan doesn't... It sort of downplays it. It's history, right? But in mainland China, this day is brought up a lot.
Okay.
And major cities to this day, you know, every year would have sirens playing throughout the cities to remind us of the past shame. This date is coming. And the Chinese government's like, ooh, we gotta be prepared.
People are gonna get emotional. It'd be like if the United States was really mad about something England did and then 4th of July was coming up.
Only if you have spent your whole life thinking 4th of July is a national shame day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Our whole life we've been taught about how we've been under the boot of England.
Yeah. So there were lots of looting, arsoning, and 7-Elevens in China were getting attacked. On the record, at least 50 Chinese cities had large-scale protests and violence, and that's on the record. And people were injured. As reported by International Business Times, Honda temporarily closed down all of its 5 major assembly plants in China. Nissan temporarily closed 2 of its 3 factories in China. Mazda decided to suspend production of its Nanjing plant for 4 days. And Canon temporarily closed down 3 of its factories in China. So there was significant economic damage over this. And the Chinese government and state media had ramped up their nationalistic rhetoric compared to 2005, especially at the early stages of the boycott and protests. It almost looks like they wanted to sort of ride the wave, and this was an opportunity to point out and say, see, Chinese people feel very strongly about this. It matters a great deal to us. You know, it's legitimate that we should hold on to these islands.
Mm-hmm.
However, soon it looked like it was going to get out of control. National medias, after the second wave of more violent protests, all came out and pretty consistently asked people to not get violent. They all laid out the economic realities of the boycott. These Japanese goods are made in China. The Japanese cars are owned by Chinese consumers. It's not doing anyone any good to burn down a Japanese store.
Yeah.
Riot police was dispatched in major Chinese cities as well, and violent protesters arrested and detained. So that was the largest violent protest that actually had actions on the streets in China. And after that, we sort of entered a new stage of Chinese boycotting. It was more and more frequent, however, less and less about protesting, marching, getting on the streets.
Because they don't want people to do that. Tiananmen Square didn't start off as an anti-government protest, right?
It did not.
And so there's that fear, I think, that once people are on the street and talking and getting fired up,
yeah,
they can decide what they really
think they're really angry about.
Yeah.
They could blame the government for not doing enough to against Japan. The anger could easily be redirected.
Yes. You don't want the people marching around.
Yes. You don't want to play with fire. Or the Chinese say, water can carry a ship and it can sink a ship.
Wow, Jerry. That's so wise.
Thank you. It was ancient Chinese wisdom. The boycotts emphasized more and more on consumers' choices. A more pure form, you could say, of what boycott actually means in this context. That means I'm not going to spend my money on a certain brand of goods or a certain type of goods. Use that action or inaction to express my opinions over an issue.
Which is not really historically the kind of boycott that does anything. Because, I mean, a real boycott, it I don't know if violent is the word, but it's more aggressive than that, right? You don't buy the stuff. You smash the shops that sell it. If you see somebody wearing it, you know, you harass them in the street, you tear it off, right? It's
It's not just you not spending your money.
You have to create an aura where it's socially unacceptable to be doing it.
It also happens that way. Okay. But, you know, no one's allowed to burn down any cars anymore.
Mm-hmm.
For example, an airline would list Taiwan on its website without marking it as a region of China. Therefore, this airline company must be pushing the agenda to divide China. Or a makeup brand would quote Dalai Lama on social media about, like, you know, just be chill about life. And then it would get accused of supporting Tibet independence. And it must be boycotted to let Chinese people's voices known to this little makeup brand from America that has so much power. Recently, NASA was boycotted in China, which this was a weird one.
What does NASA sell in China?
Nothing. So, NASA doesn't get its funding from Chinese people. I have no idea. But
The gift shop?
Maybe you can boycott the gift shop, you know?
Yeah.
Like you said, I don't know how we boycott NASA.
That's more of a metaphorical boycott.
Yes. So basically, NASA had this event. It's called Send Your Name to Mars. Cute, right?
Yeah.
And you enter your name, location, and your postal code, and they will save it to a chip, and that gets sent to Mars.
Mm.
People all over the world would participate. Mm-hmm. And
this is for the rover that landed a couple weeks ago.
Still happening. I think it's ongoing. Like, I went on the website today, and it was still happening.
Oh, well, maybe they're broadcasting.
I think it's a continuous effort.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's hopeful.
And the mistake they have made was that when they ask you to enter your location, the name of the list says countries. And Taiwan was one of them.
Mm.
And oh my God, what a crime. So NASA was trying to divide China.
You know, from the perspective of an ardent CCP nationalist, it's like, those Americans, they're trying to sneak it in again.
Yeah, no, they are. They're trying to play
edge ball. If we let the NASA drop down menu go.
It's a zero-sum game. It's a slippery slope. NASA never officially responded. Last I checked, Now it says select a country / region / territory. Just everyone is included. Mm. It's an inclusion party. I don't want to comment on that. You know, maybe they just didn't. It doesn't matter. I've talked to Taiwanese people in my life, you know, and they go, well, you know, we're used to it. It's very annoying. And obviously China has missiles pointed at Taiwan. So there's bigger problems than not being recognized.
Yeah.
But it is a form of international bullying. But, you know, that's okay. We can just tell ourselves Taiwan's part of China.
They're going to recognize those gay marriages?
Well, some people joke that China has gay marriage now because, you know, it's part of China. We're very progressive. So these boycotts happen so often now. The Western brands have developed a procedure, a playbook for when they get boycotted. They release a statement in China, in Chinese, saying that they respect China's national sovereignty, they respect Chinese people and Chinese consumers, they respect Chinese law and wish for nothing but to contribute to Chinese society, because that's what capitalists do. Mm-hmm. They contribute to society. I'm being sarcastic. And so they might get pulled from some of the online stores that are the big ones, right? Taobao, Tmall, and they might lose some sponsorship deals. So, you know, they might lose money. They probably will most of the time. They lay low for a while, and then most of the time it's back to business as usual.
Mm-hmm.
For a lot of them, it does blow over, especially if the boycott is one of those that you just can't know for sure, if the voices of boycotting is amplified instead of born naturally out of a consumer's personal choice.
Mm-hmm.
So that goes to...
Well, because the CCP has its claws everywhere, right? And so, you know, if Taobao takes down Nike products, that doesn't necessarily mean everybody at Taobao feels really strongly about it. It could just be
No, but you have to pick a side officially on paper, and that could cause them to lose some money.
Yeah.
And it's not to say, I'm not here to deny that the Chinese market is a huge market and still growing, right? Mm-hmm. Even though growth is slowing down. These businesses, they want to make money in China. That's what they do.
Yeah.
Especially in these cases, if it's over the issue of like, Taiwan is a part of China. Sure, on the passport, it says China.
Yeah.
They don't have enough political backing internationally.
And also, people in the U.S. don't care that much. No, if a drop down says country / region.
Not people in the U.S., people worldwide.
Yeah. Well, a lot of these companies are U.S. companies.
Well,
though.
H&M is European. Swedish or, yeah. So, no, but I mean, internationally, other consumers, they also have to serve other markets.
Yeah.
Right? The big ones, Europe, America.
India.
The consumer, India. The consumers don't care enough. I'm not saying they should or should not. They don't know about it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not something that touches their daily life. So for these boycotts, once it happens, any celebrity that has a commercial deal with them must break the ties, because otherwise the fire is going to burn towards them.
Yeah.
And any state media or anyone who speaks on Chinese social media, really, that are famous, you better pick the right side. Otherwise, you will almost definitely get chastised by state media. Mm-hmm. And your followers, the nationalists.
There's this bit in 1984,
mm-hmm,
where one of the things is you have like the hate hour, where on the TV every day they show whoever the villain is of the state.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody just has to yell at the TV.
Yeah, it's like that on Chinese social media.
Yeah. Who's the person who slept in late and didn't hear about this new drama, right? And some video.
Who did not say that they hate this brand and they will never work with this brand ever?
Who slept in and had a video auto post featuring a brand that is now...
Silence is not an option.
Yeah.
In 2018, fashion brand Balenciaga was boycotted in China because of its mistreatment of Chinese shoppers in Paris. There was a, you know, physical fight within the shop.
Okay.
And I guess Balenciaga wasn't sensitive enough to protect Chinese people in that fight. Again, not to argue whether, I don't know, the guards of a mall in Paris understands international relations. However, they messed up.
Okay.
In the eyes of the Chinese people. So Chinese social media went to bat over this, saying that Balenciaga is racist against Chinese people, hurts China's feelings, and it can now say goodbye to the Chinese market. Fashion bloggers blurred out the Balenciaga logo in their videos and posts. It was a name not to be mentioned, only to be condemned for a short while. They apologized and it blew over.
Yeah.
You know, Balenciaga's in China. Well and fine. Well, I don't actually know if they're involved in the Xinjiang cotton, so maybe not. NBA was boycotted in China in 2019. This was a more recent one, over one of its team managers tweet
said something in support
over the Hong Kong protests, and he said something about support freedom, support Hong Kong.
Yeah.
And Chinese internet again went to bat.
They
wanted him to get fired, wanted NBA to apologize and all that. And NBA this time did not back down, right? Yeah. He was not fired.
Well, I mean, not back down isn't strong, because like, they didn't really even stand up. It's just one guy who was involved with the NBA said a thing.
By not firing him, that was not backing down.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
They didn't kowtow.
Yeah.
You know, kowtow. So the boycott started on October 6th, 2019, with the Chinese embassy in Houston, America, demanding an apology from the Houston Rockets because he was a manager of the Houston Rockets, right? And that was met with lots of backlashes over America.
Yeah.
Because NBA is... I don't know how else to say it, is wholeheartedly American, right?
Yeah.
It's so American. And it, in a way, and it touches, now it touches on the issue of freedom of speech.
Yeah.
Which, again, something that Americans care about, left or right.
Yeah.
And you probably know more about the pushback.
It's one thing when things just, it's like, okay, what do you call Taiwan on a website? Most people in the United States do not know or care enough about the one China situation to feel strongly about it.
No.
Right? And they're just like, China's being annoying, right? But like, when it's Hong Kong and the protests are on the news for like 6 months straight, and you know, they're trying to ban, I mean, people feel strong about, or like the Xinjiang Cotton, when it's like, oh, there's a genocide going on.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that's not a question of terminology, right?
No. Yeah.
I mean, the UK has since officially said it's a genocide. So it's like, you kind of, as a company that's, you know, if people understand what that means.
Yeah.
And you kind of have to pick a side if you're a company, right?
Yeah. It's more black and white than anything about whether Taiwan is a country
or
called
what,
Taiwan.
Or who's a rock in the middle of the East China Sea belongs to.
However, over Hong Kong, that has sort of opened people's eyes.
Yeah.
And had everyone's, you know, 101 about Chinese politics.
Yeah.
And how these boycotts could work, especially over this NBA issue. So NBA, I would say they didn't back down by my definition.
Yeah.
By comparison to everyone else. The boycott happened on October 6th, right? Started on October 6th. It was trending on Chinese social media and America. And on October 12th, only 6 days after that, there was an in-person game that was supposed to be boycotted in Shenzhen. And that game was guarded by police on the ground, and it happened on schedule.
Yeah.
And everyone who bought tickets went. I mean, okay, not everyone, but there was no, you know, it wasn't like no one went.
Yeah.
People who spent money on those tickets, they wanted to enjoy basketball and they went.
Yeah.
Which, that in a way tells you that, obviously that's a small sample, right? Obviously, people who buy these tickets are NBA fans and care about basketball enough. But those are also the consumers of NBA. And that goes back to the issue of whether the voices of these boycotting are amplified and supported by the national government, right, and state media, or it's actually a grassroots movement.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, they're basically never grassroots movements, because you can't have grassroots movements in China because you can't organize politically.
People make it happen. Sometimes.
Wow.
With lots of obstacles.
And sacrifice.
And sacrifice, yeah. NBA streaming was pulled from Chinese TV and major Chinese websites and sponsors for almost a year. However, a year later, October 9th, 2020, NBA is back on Chinese TV quietly. I looked through the major Chinese sports websites, and NBA is no longer banned. Just, it blew over, I guess.
Yeah.
That begs the question, are Chinese boycotts effective? Well, I will say that depends on what you think the goals of these boycotts are.
Yeah.
So
they're effective at getting a Twitter post from the company saying, we're sorry.
Exactly.
They're not actually, they don't seem to be effective at actually changing what these companies are doing or how they operate.
Yeah. So sometimes boycotts are, most of the time, boycotts in China are propaganda by the government and state media to promote nationalism, right? And sometimes I think they're a distraction for more serious domestic issues.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes it's a political training, right? To mobilize the people, to train them to go where you point. When the government. So that's the
goal.
You got
to kill sparrows before you can kill college professors.
Look for our episode on, what was the name of the episode?
Korea to COVID.
We did an episode on the Four Pests campaign. It might have been the third or the fourth episode. Yeah. So if you scroll up on your app,
we get it.
So in that sense, I think they're pretty effective. It's sort of a self self-congratulating thing.
Everybody can feel like they're a warrior for China because they didn't go to, I don't know, they didn't go buy Nike shoes for 2 months.
Or sometimes I would also think that these boycotts is there to sort of distract the fact that Chinese people cannot vote. And therefore, does that mean you don't have a voice in society? But these boycotts tells you, falsely sometimes, right, that you have a voice, that you can push for social change with the money in your pocket and your purchasing power. And maybe the money...
Vote with your wallet.
Exactly. Citizens United would agree, I would say. and, you know, we can wield the power of consumerism. When we buy a purse from, or not buy a purse from a fashion brand, it's like we're saying, I'm defining what kind of Chinese person I am, and China stands.
That's so late stage capitalism.
No, it is.
That's like, not only is your, like, brands is like your personality, but also your political, like a political statement too.
Yeah, right? But that's all you have in a society where you can't vote. So the only vote you have is your money.
I mean, and not even just vote, right? You can't march, you can't organize, you can't protest, you can't form a political group, you can't strike.
But in socialism with Chinese characteristics, you can participate in market economy. So that's your way out. That's your voice being heard, right? I'm being sarcastic. Maybe.
I mean, it's all you got.
I'm not saying that's not true, obviously. And I'm quoting someone that there is no such thing as ethical consumption under capitalism. Not at the end of the day, right?
Yeah.
But obviously, you can choose to spend your money more wisely and to avoid more exploitation than
otherwise.
You can
strive to do less, but you can never fully understand the economic ramifications of what you're buying.
No.
Because there's so many people and so many companies and so many things involved, right?
Too many hands in a pot.
You might have your free trade coffee beans, but you know, maybe the bag that it's woven in was made by a slave labor or something somewhere.
Yeah. So you can obviously try to do better. There's no absolute ethical, you know, that we would be lying to ourselves. But again, the point is that, yes, you can choose to do better. And sometimes that works, right? To a degree.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm not saying an illusion.
Also, not saying that a lot of these Chinese boycotts are about, quote unquote, being better.
being a better Chinese person, maybe. So is this just all an illusion, you know, this power of personal choice? And I would say, yes, it is, especially for these nonsense ones. However, not all boycotts are born equal.
Okay.
People are, boycotts aren't.
You're a regular enlightenment philosopher.
Yeah. There are a few boycotts that two of them I want to talk about.
So these are grassroots boycotts then?
Yeah, more grassroots than the other ones. So Dolce and Gabbana in 2018 made what I call another dumb racist ad. So prior to their fashion show in China, they made a video featured a Chinese model in attempting to eat pizza, spaghetti, and cannoli with chopsticks. And oh, it was so difficult. And, you know, is the cannoli too big? It was very suggestive and very offensive. And its designer called Chinese people racial slurs on Instagram. And later said that their Instagram account was hacked, if you believe that.
Heated gamer moment right there.
Yeah, exactly. Dolce & Gabbana was boycotted in China. Obviously, the playbook is sort of similar if you look at what happened, then these nationalist boycotts as well. Every celebrity walked out the fashion show. Every celebrity that had a sponsorship with them severed ties.
Yeah.
Chinese internet was condemning Dolce & Gabbana all over. And that was actually pretty effective. And I think it was effective in a way because Dolce & Gabbana and the designers involved in this, they're assholes internationally. They've gotten into trouble with so many people. And Elton John has started a hashtag says boycott Dolce & Gabbana.
Okay.
China didn't start it. They've had a lot of backlashes over the years. So this racist ad was just one of them. Dolce & Gabbana hasn't really recovered commercially in China. Mm. And it is not standing in fashion communities all over the world either.
Yeah, because it's one thing a manufactured crisis, but when people actually are annoyed at something, that has a weight to it, right?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, why aren't we buying Nike? Oh, because we're not supposed to. But it's like, it's another thing if it's like, why are we buying Nike? It's like, well, because they're like really racist.
They have committed a series of offenses. Worldwide. So that was, I guess, one example where not all boycotts are born equal. And there's another one in 2021. So this happened really recently. So Bilibili, Chinese video sharing website, was boycotted in early 2021 over its tolerance of misogynistic content and comments all over its website. They apparently released this web series that was like very sexist and sort of very troublesome. The female users of the website recognized the web series is just one of the problems that the website has.
Yeah.
And it's in line with its misogynistic tradition and tone. Mm. Undertone. So the push from female users has ultimately been the catalyst that led local Chinese brands to cut ties with Bilibili.
Mm.
And one company said, "We firmly oppose and strongly condemn any forms of insulting behavior or remarks against women. We respect women and care for them." Whether that's sincere or not, that was a statement posted on Weibo. In similar style, you could exchange women to China, right? Like in words. But they're not defending China this time. They're defending women and women's rights. So that was another example of sort of grassroots movement that's not under the name of nationalism.
Yeah, so not every boycott is because of foreign company. I mean, Chinese people...
We boycott each other.
Yeah, Chinese people obviously... So, I mean, like so many of these boycotts are so artificial.
It's refreshing.
There is some legitimacy to the voting for your wallet. Like
voting with your wallet.
Voting with your wallet.
Yeah.
Internally. And those seem to actually... be more effective than the kind of state manufactured ones that flare up and go away in two months.
Yeah. So not all boycotts are born equal. However, I'll say though, it's also being used against women in China when the Bilibili case was, you know, women voicing their opinions.
Mm-hmm. Oh, like, oh, women ruined this for us or something.
We can go on for days. But, you know, now there is new waves of boycotting brands that use women who are outspoken about women's rights. Or,
I mean, that's like right now with Republican Party in Georgia trying to like boycott Coke and stuff, right? Of like.
Why are they boycotting Coke? Coca-Cola?
Because Coke came out against the Georgia voting restriction
laws.
Oh,
yeah.
Right? Or boycotting the Major League Baseball, right? Like, because...
Which is so American.
Right.
Which is ironic, yeah. Back to the boycott that has inspired this episode.
Mm.
Internationally, consumers have become more attuned to ethical consumption.
Yeah.
Who makes their clothes? Where did all these material came from? So that puts pressure on brands to understand their own supply chain. So with this as the background, last summer, 2020, many Western brands, fashion brands, issued statements expressing concerns about human rights in their supply chain.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them cut ties with Xinjiang altogether, large cotton export region in China.
Mm-hmm.
So this happened, however, last summer. Mm-hmm. And the boycott happened this year. In March. And why now? Obviously,
why
I don't know
later?
For sure.
Yeah.
However, earlier this year, America, England, Canada, right, all declared their positions on the Xinjiang issue.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not here to argue about those because I think it's self-evident.
Yeah.
But, you know, I urge you to, New York Times has done a series.
If you're listening to this podcast, you know what's happening in Xinjiang. UK just declared it a genocide. It's not like it's a... It's not a secret anymore. Yeah, it's not a secret.
Yeah. So that has happened this year, which lots of people think that this is why now China has to push back. That might be a major reason for the timing. And so late March 2021, screenshots from a statement posted in September 2020 by H&M on their website, citing deep concerns about reports of forced labor in Xinjiang and confirming that they have stopped buying cotton from growers in the region. These screenshots began circulating Chinese social media and started trending. Even though the report was posted in September 2020, it really sort of blew up this year. Right after all these declarations of the Xinjiang issue.
Yeah.
Leading Chinese e-commerce platforms have kicked H&M off their sites. I last looked, Nike's still there. I think, like I said, you know, H&M seems to be the sacrificial lamb of the group.
I actually heard a statement. It's like, oh, Sweden's a small country, so it's easier to bully them.
Mm.
Right?
Could be, yeah.
They're not like many other Swedish companies, like maybe IKEA, I don't know.
So then what happened was that because it's very recognizable, a Nike, H&M maybe not so much.
Yeah.
On TV, celebrities, not celebrity themselves, but you know, obviously, their team would blur out their sneakers. Fashion bloggers who make fashion videos would blur out the logos of these brands. And there's a lot to blur out. During those 2 weeks, you watch TV, it's all ridiculous. And because obviously it's sort of, you can say that, okay, yeah, they're really representing China, right? They're really making their stance known that they don't want to represent these brands.
But it's also showing, however, how much stuff you have to blur.
First, how much stuff you have to blur. Second, you're still wearing them, right? Yeah. It's just, we're all pretending that we're doing something, but we're not. I'm not saying you should actually burn the shoes. I'm pretty sure some people did, but no one's burning shoes on TV. So everyone's doing this. Everyone just pretending. I think they're pretending. I don't know if they think they might be very proud that they're doing it.
Yeah.
I don't know. And well, I mean, on the other hand,
they should just not wear. I mean, if they're serious about the boycott, they should just not wear.
Well, they
don't
want to remake the program now.
Yeah.
I think it's just that's okay. That's acceptable, right? Because we're pretending. And the other thing is, if China really wanted to boycott something, if China really wanted to boycott a brand from a certain country, they have done it. Right? Google's not in China. No one's boycotting Google.
Nobody called for a boycott of Google. Nobody was on the streets marching against Google.
Yeah. And you know what? Last year, when China and Australia was having very tense relationships, probably still today, China stopped importing Australian coal. Some cities were told to like just brace themselves for the hard times that are coming this winter, because there won't be enough coal. China still burns coal as its
primary electricity
source. And no one was boycotting Australia coal. We just banned it. And Chinese government, just a matter of the fact, is that, I mean, this even comes up with the international summit that Biden is going to do with the environmental stuff. That Western powers, governments, businesses understands that if Chinese government really wants to do something, they do have the collective power within China to get it done. Because you would argue, you know, Trump's here for 4 years and now you're here. What happens in another 4 years? You could reverse actions, right? Which in America, like with the global warming stuff, has been reversed many times over.
Yeah.
And then they put the sort of a trust on China because they go, well, if they really put their heart to it, they can achieve it because they control everything, right? At the end of the day. Obviously, we have a market economy.
Yeah, you can't do everything, but the stuff that the government decides to do, they can do.
They can achieve it.
Yeah.
So then it goes to, let's just assume that the government is wholeheartedly working for the people. Then why doesn't the government just ban H&M?
Yeah.
And the reason that they can't just actually ban it, same as 2005, 2012, with all these Japanese boycotts, China's economy is deeply, deeply integrated with the world. Textile industry is huge in China. How many of these clothes are made in China, right? How many retail stores they have in China?
And also, if they ban too many things, companies go like, yeah, we're not getting involved in China. Right? And that
hurts. No, it's a high-risk environment.
It hurts investment, right?
Yeah, and China, and we need foreign investment, you know what I mean? As much as now the current government is trying to push or create the illusion that we're going to create a self-sufficient economy. The Chinese economy, we can make everything ourselves, consume everything ourselves. Oh, okay. We don't need to trade.
That's the middle kingdom right
that's
there.
That's the middle kingdom right there, right? But that's the official policy.
If you want to buy anything, pay in silver.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the official policy, like so that we are less dependent on international economy and less dependent on trade. So if that's the case, right, then sure, boycott them, right? Ban them, whatever. But you can't actually ban them without affecting China's economy deeply.
But it's a bluff. They're thinking like...
So it's a bluff.
Yeah. Because in the end,
feel outraged that they don't use a cotton from an area of China that I'm not allowed to know what's going on anyways?
Yeah.
But, you know, obviously they tell you that you do care. And the interesting thing is, the fashion companies, they did not back down. Most of them didn't. Hugo Boss, let me name one, immediately after the boycott came on and said, oh, we use Xinjiang cotton. We will continue to always use Xinjiang cotton in our supply chain.
Yeah.
It was a Chinese statement that had been posted. And journalists go, what? We have inquired many times whether you use Xinjiang cotton. You've said no. And then later on, Hugo Boss came out and said, oh, we don't use Xinjiang cotton in our supply chain. And it's sort of, okay, yeah, lots of credibility there for someone who had made Nazi uniforms.
Well, I mean, it's like you said, there was, you know, there is a playbook.
Yeah.
And some overeager social media intern.
Or a PR company, Chinese PR company.
Is like, oh, crap,
it's
happening.
Let's get ahead of this. Yeah. Let's not get canceled.
Yeah.
Right? So that was very comical. They took a 180 turn. But most of these fashion companies did not back down because now there's a morality issue, right? And they have other markets, and America and England and these other countries came out and declared where that line is, right? So they So it's more black and white again.
Well, and also, when things start getting declared as legally as genocide and stuff, you know, you could get sanctions, you could get in trouble.
Yeah, you don't want to cross that line.
And it makes sense for you to figure out a new place to get your cotton from.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Also, can I just say, H&M, they are a fashion company.
Yeah.
They can't declare anything like that. They can't. They're not a government. Their government from that country might declare it.
Well, you know,
all they said in their report was that, like, we cannot confirm it because we can't audit it because we're not allowed in the region.
Do you know all they're
which
doing?
They're not allowed in the region. That's true.
Do you know what all they're doing, Cherry?
Yeah.
They're just boycotting.
They're just yeah, they're boycotting Xinjiang, right? Like, so now we're like, we're going to boycott
you
back.
Yeah, we're going to boycott. Hey, it's their right.
Yeah. Then the Chinese government backs down. I don't mean the foreign ministry came out and said anything, because they don't. They don't want to touch it officially, right?
You mean like the
but
Global
when
Times.
We said we mean Chinese state media.
Yeah.
First, they started. Let's not name names. You know, let's not name fashion companies. You know, they're we could do more harm than good. And then it's like, well, if you're not boycotting a specific brand, what are you boycotting? A feeling? And now, a month and a half later, and no one's talking about it.
Yeah.
The storm has passed until the next one. One thing it did, though, lots of people in China goes, what's happening in Xinjiang? Because they've never...
For the first time ever, a hashtag of Xinjiang can be on.
Can be posted on
but
Chinese social
media. But
didn't
they block it again shortly after?
They blocked it again, yeah.
Because they're like, people were asking too many questions.
This is yeah, exactly. Because in order to defend something, you got to understand it, right?
Yeah.
Obviously, people could just buy the simple explanation.
But they still... But I mean, you don't even want people
you don't
to
want
know
awareness.
That... You don't even want people to know the PR numbers that,
exactly.
That it's re-education camps.
Yes.
You just want them to think like Western people just hate China.
Yes.
That's why they're doing it.
Loud thunders, small raindrops. And that's a Chinese saying. And H&M will be back in China in a year, just like NBA was. But what are some takeaways?
That to not necessarily... take the Chinese government's propaganda's word that these boycotts of things are really because the average Chinese person feels really strongly about it because they don't. And a lot of times they don't even know why they're boycotting.
Yeah.
They're just being told to do it. And it's like, if the government tells all the e-commerce websites to take a company down, is that really a boycott? Is that really consumers choosing to do it? Or
mm-hmm.
is that just...
Well, the platforms decided
yeah,
themselves.
I'm sure they did. I'm sure the...
Yeah.
I'm so, sure the... The CCP representative comes over with a printout.
The party
yeah.
secretary,
which all these places have.
There's a party branch. Yes.
Yeah.
So yeah. So I mean, that's really good. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, you know, don't judge all Chinese people. Don't judge all my people based
yeah.
on these crazy boycotts. It does not speak for the people.
And if you're a Western company.
And if you're a Western
probably
company,
the best thing to do is just nothing. And just write it
well,
out.
Well, you know, follow the playbook, I guess.
Yeah.
Your Chinese PR company will give you the playbook. So, yeah. So, I guess, you know, it does not speak for my people. I don't either. But, you know, I speak for me. And
I think hopefully it was interesting to people because
yeah.
I think it maybe gives some people a historical context for these boycotts and why in some ways they're fake. Because the Chinese government does not actually want legitimate mass movements on the street
no.
doing stuff because
no.
it you don't
it
want
could
be,
backfire
yeah, it
very
could backfire.
Easily.
So that's why you have these weird, you know, anemic online boycotts, essentially.
Yeah. It's a show of hands without having to show up.
Yeah. That was our episode on boycotts. Hopefully you all enjoyed it. We have more exciting episodes coming up. I don't have anything else to say. Cherry, do you have anything else to say?
No. Thank you for listening. And again, don't judge Chinese people based on these crazy boycotts.
You can judge the CCP. You can judge like Global Times on them though.
You can judge the state media.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah.
Um,
well, anyway, have a nice day.
See you next time.